Hey folks.
Hello there.
I'm Adam.
And I'm Amy.
And we are going to be giving you what?
Some tips about what you should know before you go to Costa Rica, specifically the Pacific coast of Costa Rica in the Guanacaste area.
Okay. Do you want to give them an outline with some of our
So these are the things that topics? We've learned so far, and we've got some topics for you guys. We want to talk about the cost. We want to talk about tipping culture in Costa Rica. It's a little
safety.
Bit different.
Safety
the
is
safety,
next.
Transportation. You're going to want to know about that.
Yeah, there's a lot of things to know.
The drought currently. So we are going to want to talk about, it looks pretty green and lush behind us, but
it is a brutal drought.
It's
right now.
Really, really super dry. So we're going to want to talk about that.
And then utilities.
We'll talk about utilities, the water, the electricity, your cell phone service, the internet, all of that good stuff, how that works here. And also, I never thought that I would say this in my mid-30s, but the vibes.
We're going to talk about the vibes. Right.
We're going to talk about the vibes.
So let's go ahead and check it out and kick it off.
Right about now.
All right. So first off, you said that we were going to talk
about
the cost.
We're going to talk about the cost. And we normally don't do this, but I feel like for Costa Rica, it's a little bit of an anomaly. So we are going to break down our cost and we're going to tell you exactly how much our lodging cost, exactly how much our car rental cost, and exactly how much some of our dinners cost here.
Which Amy's been picking up the bill for a lot of it, so you're going to be the expert on this.
Yes.
This was your trip.
Yes.
You wanted to go to Costa Rica. You booked it. You're treating. So tell them how much
did
this beautiful
Airbnb
cost. So I paid
for this, and I will tell you, our Airbnb cost approximately $325 a night. Like, when you put in for an Airbnb, you know, obviously, we're accounting for Airbnb, you know, you've got that cleaning fee and you've got all the taxes and the whatever else, but it pretty much comes down to $325 a night, which is not crazy cheap.
No.
Also, it's not super expensive. So we'll tell you about our Airbnb. You can see behind us, we've got a private backyard. We've got a plunge pool. We are walking distance to the beach. We have our own kitchen. We have 2 bedrooms and 1.5 baths, and it's great. It's wonderful.
It's
absolutely beautiful.
Very nice.
I would say I would put this on, kind of, you know, if I were guessing, this is more expensive than you would expect in a lot of foreign countries.
Yeah, yeah. Now you have to remember,
however,
we are in a beach town. We're not too rural.
Exactly.
Potrero Beach, is that
Potrero,
correct?
Yes.
Potrero.
And we are about half a mile from the beach, a walk away. Very safe, nice neighborhood. This is, you know, it's more expensive than you would pay in some other countries. However, it's less expensive than you would probably pay in Key West.
Yeah, Key West is still like $400 or $500 a night. So
even,
for this
even
equivalent.
Even for our staycations, because we're from Florida and we've looked at, you know, like, okay, let's go to Siesta Key, let's go to Orlando, let's go to all these places. Most of the time, they are $400 or $500 a night.
I would say a comparable Airbnb in Tampa, Orlando, probably $250 a night. I think this is a little more expensive, in my opinion.
Oh, I completely.
You think it's about the same?
I completely disagree with you. I think that a hotel in Orlando that we've looked at is $400 or $500 a night for a one-person room, much less being a two-person room.
Okay.
So I completely disagree with you on the prices on that.
So then, how much is dinner?
So dinner for 2 drinks, 2 entrees, and a dessert, you're looking at $85.
So not cheap Colombian food, not cheap Venezuelan food.
No, not at all.
This, in terms of price,
or Thailand,
the price
or even
point
Japan,
is higher than a lot of places we've traveled.
Yeah, definitely.
Probably among the highest. It's probably, would you say, higher than Japan?
Yeah, definitely higher than Japan. Probably on par with a normal restaurant in Tampa, but if you're at the beach in maybe St. Pete, it's a little bit cheaper, I would say.
Okay.
I would say it's a little bit cheaper than, you know, like, this is on par for what you would get at your normal restaurant in Tampa, like a normal steakhouse, a normal, like, mid-grade restaurant. It's the same prices.
Mm-hmm.
$8 to $10 a drink, $15 for entree, something like that. Slightly cheaper than what you would get in St. Pete Beach, or slightly cheaper than what you get in Miami Beach. But But still, it's not a bargain. It's not a budget.
I personally think that prices have just gone up so much in the U.S., and that's reflected everywhere. Like, every place, things are more expensive than they were a year, 2, 3 years ago.
Right.
No, this probably would have been a much more cost-effective, when you look at the total dollars, trip a few years ago. But things are just more expensive now.
Yeah. I totally agree with you. Groceries. We bought some groceries when we first got here. It was like $45 for, you know, maybe a couple of days of breakfast and some drinks and some, you know, like some fruit and stuff like that. I felt like it was very on par with a U.S. grocery store. Basically, the point being, don't think that you're going to come here and really, really leverage currency arbitrage and think that you're going to get a really cheap place to live. You're not. It's ever but the exact same as the U.S. You can have a lot of perks here. It might be worth it. I'm not saying it's not, but as far as coming here because you think that you're going to get a great deal, or you're going to, you know, digital nomad, come here and live for a less cost of living, probably not. Unless you live in Manhattan or San Francisco, probably not.
Fair enough.
Yeah, so, tipping.
Yeah, what is the tipping culture here?
So the tipping culture in Costa Rica, of course, everyone appreciates the tip, duh. You know, like, obviously, and no one's gonna refuse a tip. That's great. If you can tip, you should, and that's a great thing to do. However, it's not the same as the US, where it is required. It's great to tip your transport. It's great to tip a tour guide if they did a really good job. And you'll probably see more in the touristic areas. They might have a little box saying like, hey, for tips. Because why not? Like, why wouldn't they do that, right?
Right.
You know, like, they're going to have a little box.
Because they
like,
know they have a lot of Americans who are probably going to throw a buck in there.
Right.
Throw $5 in there. 20.
That's great. That being said, on your menus, when you go to dinner, it will be, your menus will either have impuestos inclusivos or impuestos sin inclusivos.
With and without.
With or without taxes. And usually with and without taxes means with and without the service charge. So if you look at the price that your meal is charged, you know, it might be how many of our colonas, that's gonna include your taxes, which are 13%, and then a 10% service charge as well. So
tips are included in a lot of things already.
Yes, exactly.
And so taxes are.
Yeah, so if you see that, perhaps like most, I would say 80% of the places that we've been to, all of these service charges and the taxes are included. Some of them haven't been, and you know, they'll add that on. But the default mode is that they will be included, and that is kind of an extra 23%. That's both your service charge and your taxes that will be included in your meal. So that kind of, you know, I guess makes the charge not that bad, right?
So let me ask you a question.
Yeah.
When we went to Hemingway's, which is a beach bar half mile down the road, was there a line that said tip when you signed the credit card receipt, or was it just here's your total?
Yeah, it's just here's your total. Most places you can't even add a tip if you wanted to. You know, like, I'm
sure. Which makes sense because they're already charging you
10%. They charge you 10%
plus tax.
That you're getting at 10% in tax, you're already charged. If you do want to tip above and beyond, of course you can tip in cash.
Sure.
But in general, it's different from the U.S. to where you're not like adding your specific tip. It's already included. It's already factored in. It's figured in.
Figured in, as Captain Lou Albano would
yes.
say.
Yes.
So we did individually tip, like we had tour guides and some drivers, because those were more of a cash basis and like, oh, you're leaving and here's 20, here's 10, whatever it may be.
Yeah, a fun
so
tour.
So we did tip some tour guides and things like that as we left.
Absolutely. And they kind of have little boxes or little places where you can do that. And I would say the difference between, like a lot of people ask, do I need to change all of my currency into colones?
Yeah. Do you need to change your currency into the local currency?
No.
No.
No, probably not. We haven't had to anyway.
I haven't had to use any.
Yeah, we can use our credit cards. We can use our dollars for the most part for tips. They are readily accepted. And I think anything that's like under a 20, absolutely, you're going to be able to, they're going to be able to take that absolutely anywhere.
We went to a restaurant last night and I had 100, so I broke that. And then we were able to use that to, you know, buy a soda here, do this and that. Almost every place has taken credit card too.
Yeah.
So I think a lot of people, when they come to a country, they're like, do they take credit card? Is my visa going to have any issues? They had no problem taking my visa. Anytime we went someplace, if I just need to get a drink or if I need to get a snack, I could run that grocery store, et cetera, et cetera. No problem at all. And if I wanted to pay in cash, I could. The only place that was cash only was a barbershop, which then I didn't go to because I didn't have my credit card on me.
So quick tip on that.
I didn't have cash on me.
When you run your credit card, your server, your, you know, the person that's helping you is probably going to ask you, do you want this to be in colones or do you want this to be in dollars? Always say the local currency because you are going to get a more favorable exchange rate.
Yes.
From Visa, MasterCard, Discover, Amex, whatever you're using is going to negotiate on your behalf. And they are going to get the best exchange rate possible. If you say, oh, just do it in dollars, they're going to go on whatever they feel like the exchange rate is that day.
500, some say 450. It can vary 10, 15% very easily. Not in your favor.
Exactly. So always say the local currency, and that's going to, you know, save you some ducats.
Another tip is that when somebody charges you for something, don't just hand them your credit card. That's not customary here. Mm-hmm. I think in the US, a lot of times you just give your credit card over to the waiter and they take it back and they swipe and they do all the magic and then you just sign it. Here, you're gonna insert it yourself. You're gonna press some of the buttons. I think there's a little bit of a, you know, it's just a different culture. Like, no, you don't give your credit card to somebody. That doesn't even make sense when you think about
it. Yeah, Europe's the same way.
You run
Latin
it yourself.
America, absolutely.
You do the tap yourself. Yeah. And it is
look at your bill easy. Beforehand. Yeah. We haven't had any problems. We haven't had anything sketchy, but I have heard that sometimes for foreign people, you know, maybe there's a few extra drinks added to your tab. Maybe there's, an upcharge. We haven't had any issues, but it's always a good idea to just look at your bill beforehand. And maybe, I know, I'm bad about this. In the US, I never look at that.
Yeah.
But I've made a point in Costa Rica to always kind of like at least give a glance and a check over.
A lot of people say they've got a beer or two added to that if you're drinking
right.
for the night. So just be careful of
that.
What I did notice though, like if I paid for parking or if I just had a attendant somewhere, they will gauge that you're a tourist. They will charge you more. And a lot of times, you know, people are people. They're going to, like, I pulled into a parking spot. I'm pretty sure it was $2 to park there, just off in the middle of nowhere. Guy comes up, don't even know if he really worked there. He's like, yeah, it'll be, you have to pay me for parking. And I said, how much is it? And I had a $5 in my hand, and I'm pretty sure he switched it from $2 to $5 because I had a $5 in my hand.
Right.
So you can be cautious of that, but don't get too upset if that sort of thing happens. Sometimes that sort of thing happens and you have to not let it ruin your day or whatever.
Yeah.
It's like, all right, he got me for $3 because tourist tax. Got it.
So speaking of like the parking and everything, let's talk about the safety here. You
we'll disagree a little
okay,
bit.
Okay, we will a little bit. Yeah, we can disagree. So safety, how are you feeling?
All right, I feel safe, but I think in this town and every town we've been to, there's a significant crime factor and things go missing factor. Again, not feel like I'm going to be physically assaulted in a bar or mugged.
And again, this is in Guanacaste, Puerto Rico. So, not Puerto Rico, sorry, Costa Rica.
Costa Rica.
Sorry.
But for example, we have a locked gate that locks with a deadbolt, a fence here. Every property around us seems to have barbed wire or a very high security fence.
Yeah.
Usually both. Then on top of that, there's deadbolts on the windows.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of the houses have bars on the windows. Everything's locked up out back. And they literally tell you don't park out on the street. Someone will steal from your car. And you hear a lot of those stories. We haven't experienced it, but I can tell you based on the police driving around with their lights on and the amount of security. They tell us to set your alarm if you like the house alarm when you leave. I would say there's definitely a criminal presence. We haven't witnessed it. But when every house has bars on the windows, you know, something's up.
So I totally agree with you. I was trying to disagree with you and I can't. Overall, I do feel very safe in this country. However, it is true, when you pass by every single property that has barbed wire over their fences and giant gates and steel cages and, you know, their windows locked in with, you know, metal bars, you kind of know that something's up.
Sure.
And even our Airbnb said, you know, this is a safe area. However, if somebody steals something from your car, that's not on us, because that's pretty common. Like, don't leave anything in your car. So
Every place you park has a parking attendant.
Yeah, I would say that petty crime is very common here. Not to let that dissuade you from coming here, but just know that
be smart.
When you come here, be smart and you know, have your wits about you. Don't leave things in your car and just don't be a target. My friend from Colombia would say no dar papaya. That's it doesn't really translate exactly, but don't give papaya. Like don't
get papaya.
It's don't give papaya. It doesn't make sense. Never
don't
mind.
Don't put your stuff out
Never
there
mind.
For people
don't
to
put
take.
Your, yeah, don't
put
don't
your
be
stuff
an
out
e-
there for
yeah.
someone to take.
Don't be an easy target.
Criminals are opportunists, and they're going to take the easiest thing they can. So if your house is locked up, if you turn on the alarm, they're probably not going to mess with you. That sort of thing.
Exactly.
So,
and if you do that, I do feel like you are pretty safe here in this country.
Does that bring us to transportation and car rental fees next?
Absolutely. So we had kind of a story of I booked a car rental. We
Expedia.
Saw on YouTube that Expedia and a lot of the car rentals in this country, I don't want to say scam. Scam is a harsh word, right?
Sure.
But that you think that you're paying a few hundred dollars for a car rental, and then you get there and they want this fee and they want this insurance and they want this
and
they want this deposit, and sometimes it can be several thousand dollars, and sometimes it's a limit of a car that's not gonna work. And we just decided, you know what? I don't wanna do that.
Yeah.
I don't wanna do that. So just so you know, the car rentals, maybe it's a scam, maybe it's not. Just be ready for that. Just be ready for if you think that you're going to get a car rental for $200, you're not. It's going to be really expensive.
Even if you're using like Expedia and whatever, because you get there and they're going to have the required
by
law insurance, their taxes, and it'll be a few hundred dollars more.
Potentially thousands.
$300 to $500.
Potentially thousands.
Depending on how long. I was saying we're here for a few days.
Yeah. So, we decided actually to get a transport from the airport, and I'm so happy with that decision. It was about a little over $200, so a little over $100 each way. And I think that was totally worth it, because we didn't have to, you know, take a shuttle to the rental car place. We didn't have to wait in line. We didn't have to do anything. We had a guy that just picked us up at the airport, took us straight actually to a grocery store, which was fantastic. So we could go to the grocery store and we could pick up supplies for the week. Took us to our Airbnb, and then on the way back, they knew exactly the time that they need to pick us up, so we don't have to do the math. They know the time, like, okay, we can get here and like here to the airport in this amount of time, and that's enough time for you to go through security and do all the things. Like, it's just nice sometimes to have somebody take care of that for you. So I highly suggest, that was great for us, to book a transportation service.
And going back to the rental car, I had heard a YouTuber earlier state that if you go online and you book a rental car and the price seems too good to be true, you get that $140 for the week.
Yeah, it probably is.
It probably is.
That's the same as everything. So if you do drive in this country, which we did because we got a car, We did wind up getting
a car for daily use.
Yes, we ended up...
which is a fun story.
Which is fun. So I would say, I'm going to skip ahead. This is not in my order. But renting other modes of transportation, because we kind of thought, okay, we'll just rent a four-wheeler for the day.
Mm-hmm.
We went to a little place and we're going to rent a four-wheeler. And then we kind of got to asking, like, oh, but what about the golf cart? What about this? And then come to find out, she had a Toyota 4Runner that she was like, okay, you can rent that one.
So I think what we're trying to say is that, you know, you can go to Avis and you can spend and you can buy all, pay all the fees and all the taxes and everything. Fine.
Right.
But what we did was when we got to the beach town, there's going to be people, small businesses that are willing to rent you a smaller car or a bike or a golf cart for a more reasonable price that won't have all the fees.
Right.
So you can pay $50 a day or whatever. And for whatever reason, I think they're kind of doing it under the table and you're not, maybe that's a good or a bad thing, but you're not getting all those extra taxes.
You don't have to have the insurance, you don't have to have all
I think if it's a little less official, you're going to pay a little less. Obviously, be careful that they don't have the return scam where, oh, you scratch this or that, you know. Maybe take a few pictures or videos of your car when you rent it.
Yeah, absolutely. So, driving. You have driven more than I have in Costa Rica. Tell everyone how is driving that you would say in Guanacaste?
If you're not used to driving in Costa Rica, it's going to be stressful. It's going to be stressful. I would say on average, when we drive, we're averaging 40 kilometers an hour, 20 miles an hour. So even going something like, if the physical distance is 7 kilometers, 3 or 4 miles, but you're snaking through a jungle, sometimes with one-way bridges, sometimes off, you know, very sketchy edges, going 20 miles an hour, and because you're going like this, it can take you 30 minutes of white-knuckle driving.
Yeah.
People passing you or people going really slow in front of you. And I think that's some of the reason why the prices here in some of these towns off on the coast, the Pacific coast, are a little more expensive. Because to get, say, a semi-truck filled with gasoline or supplies is near impossible.
Groceries,
they're bringing things in small vehicles at a time, nothing much bigger than an F-150. And that's gonna contribute to the higher price. But the overall driving, you get used to it, and I like the fact that everyone's driving really slow. Like it's crowded roads, lots of bikes, lots of walkers, bicycles, people darting in and out, but you're going 20 miles an hour, so you can always hit the brake. So you have to get used to that, and they've essentially put speed bumps all over the place. And I think probably because this is a tourist town, because tourists want to go 50 miles an hour down a road.
Right.
And you'll go off that road if you do that.
Yeah.
You'll hit somebody if you do that. So they have speed bumps, whether they're man-made, they're pouring quickcrete out on the ground, they're putting a rope out there, or it's a, you know, official. They're putting them everywhere. And they hide them. They're not like painted orange where you can see them.
Yes.
They're just everywhere.
So we noticed the difference between, I feel like in the United States, there's going to be several signs before
sign
you get to
speed
a speed bump. Like, oh, the speed bump's coming up. We're going to paint the speed
slow
bump
down.
And in a nice yellow, like, please slow down. Here, speed bumps are like hidden.
Yeah.
It's specifically to make sure that you're not going too fast when you're not supposed to be going fast. In the U.S., it's a little bit like, okay, I can speed up and then I have to slow down real fast over the speed bump. Here, I think the speed bumps
are... to maintain going that speed.
It's to maintain that you should be going slow the entire time.
Shouldn't be going more than 20.
So that's kind of fun. So can you tell them about the gas stations, maybe?
Yeah. So when we rented our vehicle from just a local vendor, it was almost like she was renting us her car. She was like, oh, do you want a car? Yeah, I got a 4Runner. You can rent that, like a 90s 4Runner. Like most of the vehicles that you'll see out here are mid-90s SUVs.
Yeah.
A lot of them
Geo-trackers.
At least on the Pacific side where we are, a lot of them will have like the snorkels to where they can go through rivers and things if you need to. But this is kind of a jungly environment.
Mm-hmm.
The vehicles reflect that. They're going very slow. And because we're up in some mountains and it's very rough terrain, there's not a lot of gas stations. Because I can only imagine it's not easy to put them in here.
Right.
Maybe don't have the infrastructure for it and don't have kind of the logistics for it.
Right.
So finding a gas station, we've seen literally two.
Both were 24 hours a day, but they're not close to the cities that we've been in. It's like
you have to make a trip to the gas station. It'll be a 30-minute drive.
Right, it's
going very slow.
Yeah, 20 kilometers or more away to get to your gas station.
And it's full service.
It's different, yeah.
In
full
liters,
service, yeah.
And we figured out the price was about $5 a gallon.
About $5 a gallon. Yeah, so expensive.
Yeah, more expensive than the United States.
More expensive.
And I maintain, I think we differ a little bit. You think that things are closer to the U.S. prices. I think they're a notch above the U.S. prices, and I think gas reflects that. I think food and groceries reflect that. For the even the beach food we're having, where you're paying $85 or $15, $20 a meal, I think you might get $10-$15 for that same equivalent meal.
Maybe.
I think it's a little more expensive, but we differ a little bit on
we
that.
We differ. I think the last time that we've looked at anything that we wanted to go to in like Orlando, it was $400 to $500 a night for one room. So the fact that we're paying $300 a night for a two-bedroom Airbnb, I think things are a little less expensive here. But don't think you're going to be getting a great deal, I guess. Yeah.
Okay.
Drought.
Oh, major drought. You can't tell by it because we do have some lush green behind us. Areas of the countryside are just smoking because of fire. You know, because it's prime for fire. It's dry. It looks like a desert. What used to be lush jungle is dead foliage.
Your voice right now is very gravelly, and I know that's because it's so dry.
And which you don't expect for Costa Rica.
Yeah, you think that everything's going to be lush and green. It's not right now. And I think, in general, we are at the tail end of the dry season. However, this dry season has been extreme. This is more than usual. And it's really dry. And so if you're coming here, it's not going to be as pretty. And also, part of that is you're not going to see as many animals, because the animals that are very native to Costa Rica that you think about, you know, the things that I want to see when I come to Costa Rica are probably going to be
monkeys,
the sloths and the monkeys. Sloths and monkeys both love humidity.
They do not do well in the dry.
So especially if you are down at the bottom of a mountain that is super dry, you're probably not going to see as many sloths and monkeys. So that's just part of it.
We wound up having to go to animal sanctuaries just to see that.
Yes. Yeah. However, I would say, in some ways, it's probably easier to drive and to get around, because we've been on several roads that literally said, this road is normally a river.
Yeah.
Like, you normally have to have not only four-wheel drive, but like a snorkel to get through this, because this road...
This is only for specially equipped vehicles.
It is normally a river. And so...
And you can drive the riverbank, not just through it, but the riverbank to take shortcuts, which everyone's doing because those rivers have not had water in.
Yeah.
We asked a person earlier, we said, when did it rain last? And he said he didn't remember.
Yeah.
And another person, it rained just for 5 minutes while we were here earlier. And they said that's the first rain they had this year. So the 5 minutes of rain is the first they had this year, but he didn't remember the last time before that it rained.
It's rough. So we're hoping that will obviously change for Costa Rica very soon, but just so you know, you might have an easier time getting around, but on the flip side of that, there are gonna be fewer animals and maybe not as lush green as you expected. Next point, utilities. You want to talk about that?
No, you can go ahead and give it a start.
Okay, so we are in Guanacaste, 45 minutes from Liberia Airport, and this area is known for having, you know, and most of Costa Rica, like, I think it's like 96% of Costa Rica has potable water, really great water, probably better than the United States water. However, in more remote areas, you should be expecting that there may be water outages from time to time. So in Guanacaste, I don't think we've had any particularly at our Airbnb, but we did experience that at Diamante yesterday. It's a
adventure park
with zip lines and things like that. And they did have a water outage probably for an hour or so. So it's not, you know, all day long.
There's some wells drying up.
Yeah.
This El Nino year, as they say, has been very rough in Central America.
Right, so you should expect that there may be a few intermittent hours where you could go without water. However, again, the water is potable. It's a lot better than other places. You know, it's better than Mexico.
The quality of water.
The quality of water is great.
Irrigation and sanitation water in more rural areas.
As far as the electrical goes, it's the same outlets as the United States, same wattage, same everything, so you don't have to bring anything to change your outlets or anything.
Mm-hmm.
It's the exact same, it's totally fine. If you are staying in a place like a home or an Airbnb or something like that, you might notice that there are little trash boxes outside, which is a little bit different. In the United States, at least where we live, there are trash cans. And you put your trash bags and your trash cans and you roll them out to the street. Here, you have kind of a metal trash box that you put your trash into.
You know where that is, right?
Yeah.
Animals, you're in a jungle.
Oh, probably, yeah. Yeah, so
that's
you
true in Alabama, too.
So you have a metal trash box, and the guy comes around a few times a week and picks up your trash off of your trash box, and it's kind of like a trash lock box, so that's pretty fun.
Trash cage.
As far as cell phones go, when I came here, I did get a message from Verizon that said, okay, like, we're going to charge you our
$10 a day.
$10 a day for being here.
But our Verizon worked fine. We just had to reboot it.
It worked. I can get texts. I can get calls. Enter? Not so much.
You're having a little bit harder time than I am, which is
not. Yeah, which is weird. I'm not exactly sure, but I have not had a good time with internet. I really need to be on Wi-Fi.
Comes and goes, for
sure. I need to be on Wi-Fi to have internet. So this may be a situation where if I had to do it all over again, I think it would be a better deal for me to get a SIM card or something local from Costa Rica rather than rely on the Verizon network.
Particularly because, if you're driving and you need GPS.
Yeah, because the Verizon network has not worked for me.
I've had not as bad a problem with it. There's areas where I don't get it. You're up in the mountains, or sometimes in the mountains you get better reception than in the valleys.
Right.
I haven't had the worst time with it. I've been fine with it.
Yeah. I've had a little bit harder time.
Something else worth noting is that pretty much every restaurant we went to has had Wi-Fi. So we're living in an era where most places have some sort of Wi-Fi. Super fast Wi-Fi. I'm able to upload large videos here from the Airbnb.
And it takes like 30 seconds to download Google Maps, so you have a map of the entire area we're going to be. So you have, you know, your map, you have all your stuff, and it's great. It's amazing. Last but not least.
Vibes.
The vibes. Tell them about the vibes.
You like the vibes. You like the chill beach vibes.
Yeah, I do.
Surfer vibes.
I do.
Expat vibes.
It's nice to be here, I would say, unlike many other touristy places that we've ever been, and that includes in the U.S. That includes, you know, going to New Orleans or Las Vegas or wherever. It's really chill here. No one is trying to upsell you. They're not trying to like, hey, come here. I'm trying to get you to go to my show, or I'm trying to sell you this or sell you that. Like, it's just really, really chill. There's no haggle culture also. Like, if you're thinking of that in Latin America, which is pretty common, I don't think that exists here.
If you're in Cancun, someone's going to be barking at you from across the street, hey, come in my shop.
Right.
Here?
No.
You can walk through a market, which we did, and no one's going to accost you, no one's going to talk to you unless you talk to them.
Yeah.
I mean, they're nice. They're like, hey, what would you like? Cool. Yeah. No, we don't have that. Yeah, we do. But it's not an aggressive selling culture, which is different than some of the other Latin American countries we've been to.
Everyone here has been super nice, friendly, but also at the same time, not overly so and not in a fake way. Because I think that in general, Costa Rica has a higher standard of living. They don't have to
They're not begging for every dollar. Well, they're not a tip economy either, so.
Exactly, so they're just sort of like, hey, like, we're gonna be very nice to you. I'm not trying to say anything about, like, they are so nice, but it's a more genuine nice than you get in some other cultures. Like, whether you're in, you know, Colombia or Mexico, where maybe people are a little over the top. In Costa Rica, it's a really genuine, like, no, we're just trying to be nice, and, like, we're chill, and we're, you know, hey, what do you want? Like, okay, I'll help you with that or whatever. But you almost have to ask, like, if you want something, you have to be like, hey, could you help me find this, this, or this? They're not trying to sell you on that. They're not trying to, you know, constantly upsell you or constantly get you to buy their trinkets or do their things or do, you know, this or that or the other. It's a really chill vibe. So I think we did find a place kind of next to the beach here called Hemingway's. And I actually had to Google whether or not, because I was like, did Ernest Hemingway ever come to Costa Rica? Like, I don't know. He didn't.
Could be Steve Hemingway.
You know, he didn't. But this place, if I had to kind of sum it up for you, is very similar to what I think old school Key West probably was. Like, before Key West became
a tourist trap,
it was Potrero. It's a place for artists and writers and vagabonds and bohemians and people to come and, you know, surf and eat fish tacos and just chill and have a really, really simple way of life. It's not the prettiest beach in the world. It doesn't have the most craziest things, but you can walk and you don't have to worry about parking and you don't have to worry about a hassle and you don't have to worry about traffic. You can just chill and eat some shrimp on the beach and enjoy a sunset and have a really, really chill time. So it is kind of that, like that beach place said, Hemingway's. Mm-hmm. He may have never come here, but I feel like this is the birthplace of, if you were Ernest Hemingway back in the day, you would come here and you would write a novel and you would chill and you would have some shrimp tacos and you would walk down some dusty streets and it would be great.
So one other thing I noticed while we're here is, to piggyback on that, I haven't seen a chain restaurant. I haven't seen a brand that owns something. It's not corporate. The beaches are still local owned. The restaurants are still owned by locals. So if you're looking for a vacation that isn't your cruise ship stop where you go to Senior Frogs,
Margaritaville, whatever. No.
It's not that. This is more of a vacation where if you want to drive through the mountains, you want to still have all the niceties that you have back home, but you want to do it in a foreign country that's unspoiled by capitalism in some ways, this is more like that. So there's something about the adventure of living someplace that's completely unlike where you've been before. However, there still are all the niceties. When you go to the grocery store here, you can still get Tyson chicken nuggets. Like,
or Beyond Meat, if that's your thing, you know? Like,
The grocery stores here seem to cater to tourists, Americans, so you can still get, you know, the Coca-Cola and the things that you're used to back home. Mm-hmm. But you're not getting McDonald's, you're not getting KFC, you're not getting some mega resort building on every inch of the beach.
Yeah, that's great.
And that may be your choice. That if you want to stay in a little motel that's locally owned on the beach that has yoga in the morning, you can get that here and probably for $200 a night.
Yeah, so this is the place for you. It's not going to be the cheapest vacation of your life, but if you just want to hang out and have something that's completely different than what you can get at St. Pete Beach, because it's just beachfront with beach dogs and people running around and completely natural, like, this is the place to do it.
All right, did you have anything else you wanted to wrap up on this, or?
I think we're good. I think we've had, you know, if you guys have any questions or if you have any comments, you can tell us more, because, you know, we've been here 5 days. We're not the experts. If you have anything to add, we would love to hear it. But also, if you have questions and you want to come to Costa Rica and maybe it's something that we can help you with, we are more than happy to answer any questions. All also. Right.
Please click that subscribe button. Thank you very much for watching. You know, we love and appreciate you, and
adios, amigos.
Adios, amigos.